moving target forever. At one time, they always thought it was eternal, and then they thought it was 20, and then they thought it was 2, and then, I don't know, it's changed and changed and changed. But I think right now, kind of the current paradigm, if I'm not mistaken, is right around 14 billion years. I think the paper's quasi-accurate with that statement, are they not?
Yeah. On number 18...
It's not like this is a new claim, you know. I mean, we all know that that's what they believe, that it's billions of years old.
Well, if I'm not mistaken, I believe that right now the current paradigm is that the universe is about 14 and a half, 12 or so billion years old, and that the Earth is about 4.6 billion years old, and I think I'm correct in stating that. But I wish I would have gotten a little bit further with that, because I'd be curious to know what his argument is with that, because I think that's where they're at with it right now.
But, I just don't see this this cherry picking argument is anything worth listening to. All he's doing is accusing me of cherry picking when he does the very same thing. And I don't have to read an entire paper by a scientist to quote a portion of what they said. This is what evolutionists do continuously in their papers, one evolutionist scientist will quote another one constantly. And if you read an abstract on a journal from a paper, they'll discuss something that they have observed or they've studied and tested, and then they'll quote a paper by another evolutionist scientist about a particular thing within what they're discussing. Well, how is that not cherry picking? They didn't write it. Why should they have to paste into their paper the entire paper by that other evolutionist scientist before they can continue with their discussion? You see the absurdity of this claim? It's ridiculous.
Now, I'm not going to argue with you on that. I agree that they do cherry pick. I mean, it was obvious. I did the Thunderfoot video in which he cherry picked. He went to Wikipedia and he picked out what he wanted his viewers to see, and then he left out some of the other evidence that was out there because he didn't want them to see him. I mean, that's textbook cherry picking. I agree with you on that. I would have liked to have heard what DPR's next point was.
Well, I would have gone further with it, except his question was, why am I cherry picking? You know, and that's not a question it's not even a valid question. If he had had some valid thing to ask or assertion to make about something instead of just a rant, we could go on forward. We have another caller, 603 area code. 603.
I just wanted to call back and apologize that I had to break off so pleasantly before. I'm in a bad cell area, so I'm about to lose service. But thank you very much for the time and the conversation.
Well,
thank you for bringing the article to my attention. Actually, I've got it bookmarked here. I'm going to go back and look into this a little bit more.
At my YouTube channel. I got several good links. I just typed in Dr. Sutherland on Shelley Summers' channel, and I got links for all kinds of stuff, even some stuff where they point out some stuff that it didn't answer. You know what I mean? Because that Sutherland report is not an end-all, be-all. It's just like a first baby step. You know what I mean?
Well, listen, he didn't create life. Ultimately, he didn't create life, but it is interesting stuff.
Okay,
thank you.
I hope you guys have a good weekend, and get out and check out the moon. It is absolutely lovely tonight.
I'm going to do that. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, bye.
Thank you.
I like her. She was
okay, somebody else would call. We have someone else calling in. Someone calling themselves Only the Facts. Let's hear it. Are you there? Are you on the air?
Yeah.
Okay.
Can you hear me?
Did you have something you would like to ask or say?
Okay. You say that evolution's not real at all, but I guess that means you deny that no speciation's ever happened before, right?
No, I don't deny speciation has happened. First, let me say that even evolutionist scientists themselves argue about what constitutes speciation. They cannot define it. They have a problem with it. You can see a video on my channel where you watch a university professor whose specialty is speciation, and he admits on camera that I actually cannot define speciation. It's a problem for all biologists. Now, I would not argue. If you want to say that speciation is cosmetic changes the shape, size, color, pattern, such things, then that's fine. I would agree that speciation is a real process.
Speciation, according to most scientists, is saying when some animal goes far away enough from the other animal, so they'll be so separated from the other animal, they won't be able to
reproduce.
Yeah.
Right. Well, there's more than one explanation for what speciation is. Actually, you'll find various ones from different. It depends on who you're talking to. But Michael, you want to take that one?
Yeah. First of all, the reason speciation even occurs, it's because of a defect. It's not because they're becoming morphologically different and can't interbreed. Like if you look at different species, say lizards, for example. Like let's say like Alaska rabbit and Florida rabbits, they can't interbreed.
Yeah.
But there's no structural change in between the two. It's caused by loss of information. It's a defect.
It's a genetic mistake that prevents them from breeding.
It's not a mistake. Like if their genomes are so different, they can't interbreed.
Yeah, exactly. It's due to a loss of information.
Right.
Yeah, it's changing in information, and that's exactly how evolution. It's exactly how evolution happens.
Okay, if there's such a large change in DNA, why are there no new structures being evolved?
Oh, and that's the point I'm getting to. I've got linked. I'm gonna post it in the chat. 6 sites with observed instances of speciation in both the lab and the field. And I'll start naming them out to you. One sec, my internet's being super slow. Okay, there's some with houseflies. Like, I think there's over 18 speciations that they've observed in houseflies, especially because, like, they reproduce super fast. One sec.
Okay, and what morphological differences are between the 18 different species of houseflies?
Well, they can't interbreed. Like, there was originally a few different species, but if scientists in the lab will isolate them or observe them being isolated in the field by such things such as geographical, rivers and stuff,
uh-huh.
They won't be able to breed, and there'll be 2 separate groups.
Okay.
And so their genomes over time will become so different they can't breed. And that's basically the driving force of evolution. And can you understand how, like, over millions and millions of years, if they're spread apart long enough and they can't interbreed at all, they will become totally different from each other? Like,
Mike, let me take over for 2 seconds. I'm going to hand this back to you. The caller needs to understand this. Over millions of years, all we see within speciation is that eventually certain...
So I can't hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Can you hear me? Okay. All we observe within the speciation, as per your evidence, is that over time certain animals can't breed within the original populations. Is that what you're saying? What we are asking you for is give us changes within the morphological structure. Let me define that for you because everybody defines this differently. A Great Dane and a Chihuahua are both dogs. And if you take the leg, if you take the leg bone of a Great Dane and the leg bone of a Chihuahua, they are different. They are different sizes,
but they're
still the same type of bone in the same place on a dog.
Yeah,
we don't consider that morphological change. What we're asking you for is during the speciation process, is there any mechanism within evolution that actually changes the morphological structure necessarily of a housefly into something else? Is there ever a time where it grows a leg that doesn't belong to that housefly? It might grow an extra leg, but that extra leg looks just like the leg of a housefly. Go figure, and it's still attached to the housefly. Can you give us evidences of that type of change? Just because one housefly can't breed with another type of housefly is not evidence, in our minds, of evolution, nor is it evidence of morphological changes. Now, Mike, I'll hand it back over to you.
Okay. Yeah, just for, you know, evolution contends that, for example, you know, fish evolved into amphibians. That's not just not being able to interbreed. That's changes in structures. You know, there's would be trillions upon trillions of changes in structure if evolution were true.
Have you ever heard of certain bacteria being able to eat nylon?
Yeah, sure.
Outside of the Japanese.
Yeah.
That is a change in structure, even though have to see a change in the physical structure to have a change in structure.
No, not
let me address that one, Martha, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
Let me address that one. What caused the ability of these bacteria, flavobacterium, to be able to digest nylon is a translational frameshift mutation.
Exactly.
Now, what we observe about translational frameshift mutations is that they produce proteins, novel proteins, which are a detriment to the organism. And when they're produced in large numbers, they cause brain diseases in human beings, like Tay-Sachs disease and Alzheimer's. Okay, so that's what happens when random translational frameshift mutation occurs that creates novel proteins. A novel protein was created that just happened to mimic the right shape of this nylon molecule so that it could attach to it, bond with it, and break it down. Okay, just happened to, right? But it's far more likely that what occurred was a programmed translational frameshift mutation, which is a process we know exists in organisms. This would be an astounding evidence of intelligent design, that the creature is capable of manufacturing a novel protein specifically to break down the nylon that it encountered in its environment. Secondly, it's not a structural change whatsoever. It's a biochemical change. It's the rise of a novel protein that's capable of breaking down nylon. It causes no change to the morphology of the bacteria one bit. So how can that be support evolution theory? Now, Micah, if you'd like to discuss that, go ahead.
Yeah, because do you have any example of where a bacteria is becoming anything else? I mean, it's hard to even imagine because, you know, if I'm not mistaken, evolutionists believe the early life was this bacteria. So you would have to say that bacteria evolved to, you know, fish and then amphibian tetrapods. You know, that would, you know.
Well, he's asking, is there any transitional forms for bacteria? Or bacteria becoming a mite over time.
Yeah.
we don't have any such thing, you know.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, that's because bacteria don't fossilize very good. The only way you can find bacteria is if they imprint on other things. And that is, it's impossible to find a bacteria fossil. It's just not possible.
No, they have bacteria fossils. They've even found
fossils in rocks that they believe
came from the moon. but you're doing the punctuated equilibrium thing. Because we don't have the fossils, that's evidence that it happened.
Yeah.
An absence of evidence is not evidence.
Yeah, if you don't have any evidence that it happened, how do you know that it happened?
I just showed you evidence. There is speciation.
No, you pointed to a biochemical change, not a morphological one.
Yeah, biochemical adaptation is not a
biochemical
change.
To the ecological one. It's a lot. Okay, how do I explain this?
That's a huge assumption. There's no evidence.
It's not
possible.
Because over time, if you split something up, how do I explain this? Evolution doesn't happen in a couple years, right? Evolutionists is what you call them. Evolutionists say that evolution took millions and millions of years, right?
I have a good question for you.
So,
how do you know it takes millions of years? How do you know it doesn't happen quickly?
Because when they looked at the fossils, they saw that it was a slow, gradual change over millions of years. Like, I can bring you up this transitional fossil. But
you can't look at a bone and tell if it changed quickly or over.
They radiometrically dated the age of the rocks around where they found the fossil.
I'd like to say something about that. Okay, here's what they do. To determine how old the fossil is, it's based on how old the layer is. Now, how you figure out how old the layer is, it's how old the fossil is. That they came up with a date for those layers back in the 1800s before there even was radiometric dating. They just made the dates up before there even was any radiometric dating methods.
They didn't know the age of the fossils then.
They don't now.
They could have guessed. They know now. They could have guessed when the fossils
were. How do they know now?
They radiometrically date the age of the rocks around it. Because when something fossilizes, the minerals get seeped into the rocks, right?
So you can radiometric date a rock.
Yeah.
Can you show me an example of that?